Waiting does not come easy to impatient people like you and me. In this age of instant gratification, we are basically conditioned not to wait for anything. If the fast food line is too long, we just rush across the street to the restaurant that is over there. If the TV show doesn't quickly become interesting, we surf through dozens of channels to find something that is. And of course, if the car ahead doesn't move the instant the traffic light changes, honk, we lay on the horn. We want life to happen according to our timetable, which is often right now, if not yesterday. There's only one problem with that mentality. We are the creatures. We are not the creator. The creator of the universe, who designed for us on this planet the concept of time, is the God of grace who sent his son on the cross to die on our place. And this perfect God has an exquisite sense of timing. And the scripture teaches us he's going to fulfill his perfect plan, as we sung today, in his time. That's what Ecclesiastes 3 is all about. Now, in chapter 1, Solomon actually lamented the monotony of life. So if you flip back there to our message 2 weeks ago, you'll see the monotony of life in verse 8. He said, all things are wearisome. Man is not able to tell it. My eye is not satisfied with seeing, or the ear with the hearing. He is monotonous in his perspective towards life. Last week, he looked at the meaninglessness of life. Chapter 2, look at verse 17. So I hated life, for the work which has been done under the sun was grievous to me, because everything's futility, striving after the wind. So he is looking at life, as Ecclesiastes 1 and verse 3 says, from under the sun. This is what happens when a non-Christian or a Christian chooses to have a myopic viewpoint, a miserable vantage point on the life that God has given him. He thinks it's meaningless. He thinks it's monotonous. But now in chapter 3, he turns the corner on his cynicism. And he shows us a different perspective on God. Here Solomon reveals that there is something above man. That is the God who is in complete control of all the events of time and eternity. He also says there's something within man, which we'll see in verses 10 to 14. God has taken eternity and he's placed it in the heart of every human being. And then at the end of the chapter, he says there's something ahead of man, and that's the reality of death. So that's where we're going this Sunday and next Sunday in this two-part message. We're going to look at something ahead of man, something within man, and something around man as well. Now, these factors keep our focus off the meaninglessness and monotonousness of life. If we remember this important perspective, and it's the one point which is the theme and the thesis of what he's telling us today, say it with me, recognize the right time for every event, which may not be your time or mine, but it's always God. God does the right thing in the right way. Look at verse 1 of chapter 3. Now, there's an appointed time for everything, and there's a time for every event under heaven. The year was 1962. Peter Singer made a song, and it became popularized by a group called The Birds. And many of you might remember the lyrics to that song. To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time for every purpose under heaven. Guess where that was taken from? This verse. Poets, authors, lyricists have drawn upon this passage in Ecclesiastes perhaps more than any other section of the Bible. They love the passage we're looking at today. Now, here's what I find interesting. In verses 1 to 8, the word time pops up 28 times. So there's absolutely no doubt in even a moron's mind what the thesis of this passage is all about. It is all about the subject of time. The appropriate time for every event, every momentous experience that you and I endure on this planet. The first part of verse 2, there's a time to give birth and a time to die. Psalm 139:13 reveals God wove us together in our mother's womb at the right time. You say, well, my baby was born 2 months premature. No, it wasn't. There is no sense of prematurity. The doctor says it's premature. The doctor's not God. God sends your child at the right time. And that passage also tells us in verse 16 that God has numbered your days and mine. He knows the moment in which you and I will take the very last breath on this planet Earth. He knew the date of our birth. He knows the day of our death. He has it all planned out. The second part of verse 2, there's a time to plant and a time to uproot what is planted. Leviticus 23 tells us that the Jewish people were, for the most part, farmers. And so their whole structure, their whole calendar was based on the agricultural year. And farmers know that you have to depend on the seasons and God's sense of timing just to survive. As farmers, you have to cooperate with the seasons. You don't plant when it's harvest time. You don't prune when you want to. And when the fruit arrives, you promptly pick it or you will completely lose it. Now, when it comes to our personal lives, we go through seasons in which we feel it's the right time to uproot from a relationship, to uproot from an occupation. And we say, this is the time to end it. And nothing flows because we're facing against God's timing. And then when we think nothing's ever going to change, all of a sudden, he suddenly uproots us. It's all about God's sense of timing. So don't push it. Don't shove it. That's what he's telling us in this passage. The first part of verse 3, there's a time to kill and a time to heal. In the first church I pastored out of seminary, we acquired with our house a little kitten called Checkers. It was a cute cat. The problem is after about a year and a half, it developed a disease. It was dying of this disease. And so one of our deacons took it out back and shot the cat. Which sounds mean, but it was not mean at all. It was the most merciful thing to do. We have two people in our church right now who are dealing with cancer. We had six over the past year who went through the throes and experience of cancer. Those who've gone through cancer oftentimes are very thankful to God for a killer. A killer. It's called chemotherapy. Chemotherapy kills the bad cells. And it kills the good cells and hopes that the good cells will return and the bad cells will be removed forever. There's a time to kill. There's a time to heal. Oftentimes, that's in the hospital, which could be a bit embarrassing due to that wonderful wardrobe that they give you. One man writes, I was sitting here minding my business, kind of letting my mind go slack, when in comes a nurse with a bright, sunny smile and that gown with the split down the back. Take a shower, she said, and get ready, and then jump into the sack. What she's talking about was the gown split down the back. They're coming to do some tests, she said. They're going to stretch me out in the rack with nothing between me and the cold, cruel world but that gown with the split down the back. I hear them coming to get me, the wheels going clickety-clack. I will ride through the halls on a table with that gown with the split down the back. Now, Lord, when I get to heaven, I will not complain if my robe is white, red, or black. Just don't give me one with a gown that's a split down the black. That's the most humiliating thing. Doctors don't care about your respect at all, do they? They don't care what you look like. If you're walking around naked, it's okay with them. But sometimes that's the place to heal. Second part of verse 3, time to tear down time to build up. We see this in large cities. Demolition crews are followed by construction crews. First there's the blasting, then there's the building. Those of you in this place who have gone through construction in your home, you've remodeled a room, you've remodeled a bedroom, a bathroom, or the whole house. Perhaps you've used Danny Manuel or Ricky, and you know that they had to knock down, they had to destroy what appeared to be beautiful in order to create something that's far more lovely for your enjoyment, to reconstruct. Verse 4, there's a time to weep and a time to laugh. That's a great statement. Pastor Ray Stebbin goes, have you ever laughed at the wrong time? I have. I was at a funeral once, and the leader asked everyone there to stand up on their feet. My friend said, what else could you stand on? And I broke out in laughter. It was the wrong time. There is a time to laugh, such as when Pastor Rick tells a joke. And there's a time to weep, hopefully not when that joke is told. The shortest verse in the Bible is John chapter 11, 35. Say it with me. Jesus wept. That's right. Job says, my eyes pour out my tears to God. Job 16, 20. The psalmist asked God to store his tears in a bottle because they're precious to the Lord. And Psalm 126, 5 says, if you sow in tears, you will reap in joy. Isn't that great? God recognizes the tears and the passion, and he replaces all that with laughter. So there's a time to weep, and there's a time to laugh. It's like the line from that classic play of yesteryear. You remember it. Sunrise, sunset, sunrise, sunset, quickly fly the years, one season following another, laden with happiness and tears. Taken from Ecclesiastes. This is the life that God has designed for you and me, to recognize the balance of everything in its perfect time. Second part of verse 4, time to mourn, a time to dance. Jesus said in Matthew 5, 4, blessed are they who mourn. They'll be comforted. Mourning over your sin, mourning over the sadness that's in the world today. There's an appropriate time to mourn. But child of God, please don't forget that the Bible says there's also a time to dance. Yes. And so the question is, when was the last time you danced before the Lord? You said never. Well, then you're being disobedient to the Word of God. Feel free to move those feet during the worship service. Feel free at any point in time to allow your heart to begin to dance. That's why I love David so much. He's the first person that I want to meet after I get to heaven and see Jesus. I want to see David. He had such a passionate love for the Lord. The Bible tells us in 2 Samuel 6, 14, David danced before the Lord with all his might. Isn't that great? They were bringing the Ark of the Covenant back to the major city, and he began to dance with great passion and great power. And the Bible tells us it wasn't a formalized foxtrot. It wasn't a ballroom dance. It wasn't the tango. He just kind of cut loose. He started going like that Kenny Loggins song of the 80s, foot loose, kick off those Sunday shoes. That's the meaning of the Hebrew word rakhod. You say, what does rakhod mean? It means to skip about. You remember when you were a child and mommy or daddy provided you with something? You did the new shoes dance. You started going up and down. We think there's something wrong with that person. God said there's everything right with that person. And there's something wrong with you and me if we never dance. If we never dance. We've been listening to bad theology and bad tradition. There's a time for us to get up and dance. It was June the 5th. 12 of us from Orange Coast went to the Church of the Ministry of Reconciliation to celebrate their birthday. And here is Pastor Jule Jones, 75 years old, cutting a rug. He's out there at the praise team dancing all over the place. I thought, I love that guy. He was so thrilled with God's love for him, just like David, that he cut loose. There's a time to mourn, but there's also a time to dance. And then verse 5 says, there's a time to throw stones, and a time to gather stones. If you travel to Israel, tour guides will tell you that God gave all the stones to an angel and asked him to distribute them throughout the planet, but he tripped and dropped them in Israel. There's a lot of stones in Israel, and they have to throw them aside if they want to create their crops, but they have to pick them up to create their walls. Time to throw aside, and also a time to build. To throw those stones aside, yes. And how about the end of verse 5? Time to embrace. Time to shun from embracing. In the Mideast, you see people embrace fully and give the kiss on the cheek. And we may not always kiss on the cheek, but we give the same embrace when we see those that we love. I mentioned last week, Christine and I had the privilege of going down to do the wedding of my oldest daughter, Carla, in Zihuatanejo, Mexico. And I hadn't seen Carla or Laurel, our daughters, for close to a year. And when we met them in the airport, it was a time of celebration, a time of smiles and joy. And 6 days later, in that same airport, it was a time for tears. It was a time to hug and kiss goodbye, not knowing exactly when we'd see each other again. This is the life that God has designed for us on this earth, Solomon says. Now, if you're a pack rat, the next verse was written just for you. There's a time to keep, and there's a time to throw away. It could be the will of God that some of you have a garage sale. It could be the will of God that you take a trip to the Goodwill, to the Salvation Army, or to that place called the dump. There are two, one man is pointing at his mother. I won't even say who that is, but that's it. We had two ladies used to attend our church no longer come here, so I could say this. Classic pack rats. Both of them decided to make a move. The men who moved those ladies came to me and said, "Pastor, never again." They've saved every single piece of paper they've accumulated for the last 25 years. Every knickknack they've ever known. There's a time to get rid of stuff, a time to throw away. Recently, the fire marshal came and checked out our building and said that that ante room, that's that little room that exists between here, the magical doors that goes into the next room, was too cluttered. They need a 36-inch walkway. So Ricky and I spent a sweat-filled afternoon clearing out that room, taking things up to the attic, and putting things in the glorious trash can out there. Now, the last time that room was cleaned out was a year and a half ago by my wife, and it stayed beautiful for 1 week. Now, listen carefully. We have the fire marshal on our side this time. Do not place absolutely anything in the ante room. If you do, we will have to be biblical and throw it away. There's a time to throw away. In the first part of that verse, there's a time to search and a time to give up for searching. And don't rescue squads know that. They search day and night, and day and night at one point they have to give up the search and end it all. Yes. Now, when it says there's a time to throw away, it's more than just trash. It's also throwing away anything that's an unhealthy habit in your life. Any addiction that's bringing you down and impacting others. Any grudge-filled attitude that you have towards a child of God because they hurt you in some indescribable way in the past, God says, throw it away. You know why God says that? Because God throws your sins away. Amen? Let's read that verse from Micah, a famous verse. Read together with me. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. Yes, you will cast their sins into the depths of the sea and put up a sign, no fishing. Leave them there. God does not bring up your sins. He doesn't want you bringing up your sins. He doesn't want you bringing up the sins of others. He wants you to let the past go. In the words of Ephesians 4:32, be kind, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ's sake has forgiven you. And so if there's any person who's hurt you in the past, and the answer for every person here is yes, there is someone, God is saying, let it go today. Walk out of here free. Because most people, even those who appeared to hurt you out of vengeance, probably just did it out of stupidity. It wasn't their design. Even the best of us blow it, amen? And the finest of us fail. Auto mechanic was in the hospital chatting nervously with a surgeon being prepped for an operation. He said, sometimes I wish I went into your line of work. Everything you doctors do is so cut and dried and tidy. Not with me. I spent a half a day taking an engine apart, putting it back together, and I always seem to have a couple of parts left over. The doctor said, yes, I know the feeling. Oh. You won't like this, but I read recently that medical errors are the third leading cause of death in the United States of America, after cancer and heart attacks. And I know that excites those of you getting ready for that new operation. But let me ask you a question. Do you think that doctor does it on purpose with the stupid, asinine, sickening lawsuits that we have in this country today? That's the reason that we're paying $20,000 a year for insurance and not even giving full coverage. We have to put out something before we get it because of the lawsuits of people who won't forgive a person's failures. Get over it. Get over it. Everyone makes mistakes. And if you're a godly man or woman, you will forgive the person who has hurt you, and you will walk away from it, just like Christ hung from this cross and forgave the sins of the world. He threw it away. I know that's a lot on throw it away, but that's my take on it. Verse 7. There's a time to tear apart, time to sew together. Referring to the tearing of the garments during a time of grief, let's read that in 2 Samuel 13. Then the king arose, tore his clothes, lay on the ground, and all of his servants standing by with clothes torn. During times of grief, Jewish people ripped their clothing. And also, it's appropriate for repentance. Let's read this from Ezra. But the evening offering, I rose from my humiliation, even with my garment and my robe torn, and I fell on my knees and stretched out my hands to the Lord my God. A time to rip it up, and then the time to get out the sewing instruments and sew it back up again. There's a time for both in our life. It's a balance of life. Verse 7. There's a time to be silent. And a time to speak. When you hear something negative about another person, it's the time to shut your mouth. It's not the time to gossip. I know the temptation. It hit me several times this week when I wanted to tell Christina something about someone that I had heard or said. Wasn't even someone in the church, someone in the neighborhood. God said, don't do it. It's not your business. What you're saying may not be true, and you'll be engaged in character assassination. That's the best time to be silent, when you hear negative news about another that is probably not true. Ah, but there's a time to speak. When injustice rears its ugly head, it's time to take a stand. It's time to speak out about what's right and declare that. When you're meeting a person for the first time and they begin to become interested in what you do and interested in the church, God is whispering, give them the gospel. Amen. Then it's the time to speak. Then it's the time to share. Then it's the time to realize Christ died for their sins. Christ rose. Then you speak out with joy and passion and happiness. A time to be silent, and there's also a time to speak. Verse 8. There's a time to love, and there's a time to hate. Now, we all know about the time to love, but have you linked into a right time for hatred? In the early 1860s, a young lawyer was making his way down to New Orleans on a riverboat for the first time. And that's when he saw with his own eyes human beings being beaten and sold naked on slave blocks. And something happened to that good man's heart. He said, hatred began to boil up inside of me. And I vowed that day, if I ever have a chance to hit this, I will hit it hard. 1864, the Emancipation Proclamation. I've studied the Civil War, and I will tell you, Abraham Lincoln took hell for that wonderful proclamation. Not just from the South, but from the North, because prejudice was accepted and applauded at that point in our history. He had no choice. His hatred for slavery forced him to rise up. And the Bible teaches that. The Bible says in Psalm 97:10, listen, hate evil if you love the Lord. If you don't hate evil, you don't really love the Lord. There's a time for hatred and a time for love. We hate abortion. We love the person who had the abortion. We hate the ravages of alcohol, and we love the alcoholic. A time for love and a time for hatred. I was talking to a pastor friend just last night about this whole issue of homosexuality that we talk about today. And the world does not want to be uncomfortable with it. God says, as a Christian, you must take what we call the uncomfortable stance. The world says, we hate homosexuality and we hate the homos. That's it. Done. Or the world says, we love the homosexual and we love the homosexual sin. Done. I'm comfortable. God goes, you can't be comfortable with that. I've called you to be uncomfortable. Because the homosexuals that I've known in my life have been the most loving, caring, compassionate people I have ever met. And it breaks my heart to see their sin. And that tears me up inside. And God says, good, live with it. Because that's what I've lived with. Love for people who sin. That's the balance, child of God. Don't run to one side or the other. Take the biblical stance on everything. Love the person. Don't love the sin. I love you. I know your sins. You love me, and you hear my sins. That's the balance. Verse 8. You know, there's a time for war and a time for peace. The Bible teaches that. Hebrews 12:14, pursue peace with all men. Peace is super important. War is also important. War is also biblical. Christine and I occasionally go down to Laguna Beach, and there's always a group of people out there protesting anything that smacks of war. I don't care if people are being encroached on by 10 enemy nations. They'd be out there with their signs. That is so doggone stupid. That is so doggone unbiblical. The Bible says there is a time to stand up for what's right. And there's a time to fight. Peter Muhlenberg was an Anglican pastor in the 1700s. He had been elected to the Virginia legislature, and he was president of St. John's Church in Richmond the night that Patrick Henry stood up and said, give me liberty or give me death. Yes, that statement was in a church, because the church drove the nation at that time. He was so moved by Henry's speech, he immediately decided to join George Washington's army. And it was a sad Sunday morning when he stood before his congregation to resign his pulpit. And he preached his farewell sermon, and he read this verse, Ecclesiastes 3:1. To everything there's a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. And looking up, he said, there's a time to preach, and there's a time to pray, and there's a time to fight, and that time is now. And he flung off his ministerial robe and revealed the uniform of a militia colonel underneath. And he recruited men from the congregation, and he became known as the German Regiment, one of the bravest groups to fight for this country during the American Civil War. Peter Muhlenberg has made America the home of the brave and the land of the free, like many of the people in our congregation today, because they fought for what was right and they did what was uncomfortable because the Bible said that's the right thing to do. Time for peace, time for war. Verse 9, what profit is there to the worker from that which he toils? Key word, toils. The man or the woman, that's you, living your life, struggling, stressing, anxious, anxiety prone, not capable of sleeping at night because you're worried about how you're going to have enough money, how you're going to have enough resources, is this situation going to happen, is cancer going to take your life, is my husband going to leave me, is my wife going to desert me, what's going to happen with my children, all the questions crossing, and he says, this is a waste of time. It's no profit. Someone said, worry is like a rocking chair, it gives you something to do, but you don't go anywhere. Let's go back and forth. It's not healthy at all. Yes, it is. We forget that there's a perfect time for everything, and there's no need ever to worry about anything. Anything. In the 1960s, the great theologian Reinhold Niebuhr was actually visiting a small church on the northeast coast of this country. He was on vacation with his family. He stopped in that evening, and the pastor noticed, the famous theologian, and he said, Dr. Niebuhr, would you open in prayer? And he stood to pray. And a member of the church that day decided to jot down his prayer, and since then, it's been prayed by millions upon millions upon millions. What did Reinhold Niebuhr pray? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. It's interesting that every person who's been in an AA group or any kind of support group was uttering those words as I spoke, Diane. Have you accepted the fact of Reinhold Niebuhr's prayer that there are predicaments and people God has never asked you to change? That's not in your capability. He wants you to let it go. Let me give you two examples. You're a mother, and I use the mothers because the fathers don't usually stress out about this stuff. It's the mothers. You're a mother, and you have an adult child, and you're stressed out about the life they're living, and you're trying to change them. God's will for you, quit. It's too late. You had 18 years. Done. Done. You can do nothing now except everything. You don't like your husband or wife, what they're doing. You're thinking, well, that's okay, I'll change them. Good luck with that one. Years ago, reporters were hounding Billy Graham's wife, Ruth, and say, come on, give us something dirty on Billy. There must be something that drives you crazy about Billy Graham. She laughed, said, oh, gentlemen, it's my job to love Billy. It's God's job to change him. Now, that's wisdom. You just love your partner. Let God change them. Take all the stress out of your life. All the stress. A couple words that changed my life when I remember them. When I'm trying to change a person or a situation because I don't like it. And if I listen to the Spirit of God, I can hear him whisper these two magical words. I'll share them with you. Here they are. It's okay. But Lord, I like, Rick, it's okay. Leave it to me. I'll take care of it. That's wisdom. That's wisdom. Verse 10. I have seen the task which God has given the sons of men to which they occupy themselves. This is interesting. You're saying, what do I do with the stress? You tell me to let it go. I can't let it go. I have that's in my pants. I got to do something with this. God goes, I'll tell you what to do. I'm going to give you some direction. And here it is. Here's the principle. You could jot it down. Don't amplify the stress. Occupy with acts of service. Say that with me. Don't amplify the stress. Occupy with acts of service. The next time you start worrying about something, God is saying, you better get involved in ministry right now. Call someone up. Pray for someone. Write someone. Study the Bible. Go out and give food to the poor. Do something. Occupy with acts of service. Take all that extra energy and stick it in the divine area that God wants you to use. You ever think about that before? That all that energy has been given for a purpose. And you're misdirecting it on something that can't be altered or changed. So harness the energy and use it to change what you can change. Reinhold Niebuhr's prayer. Yeah, that's on target. Because every ministry is a holy ministry. When you call someone to pray for them, when you write a card, when you demonstrate that care and compassion, that's a sacred ministry that's designed by God. Ruth Bell Graham put it this way. She used to have an inscription over her sink for many decades before she died. And the inscription read, "Divine service conducted here 3 times a day. Love it. Ruth recognized washing a dirty dish as an act of worship if it's done for the glory of God and the honor of Christ. Amen? 3 people believe it. That's good. That's a start. That's not bad. Not bad at all. Verse 11. There it is. He's made everything. Yeah, I have appropriate. That's the wrong term. The Hebrew term is yafed. It means beautiful. We just sang it. He makes everything beautiful in his time. Everything beautiful in his time. Everything. Dr. David Jeremiah writes, when a young couple fall in love and they get married, they're convinced that God's made everything beautiful in their time. I just love doing premarital counseling with the couples. That's so fun. I try to see, what are the things that your fiance does to bother you? Oh, nothing. They're just perfect. And I'm thinking, hey, 6 months after the wedding, they'll be in here. And they always are. I can't handle it anymore, you know. Jeremiah's right. He's a pastor. He knows. Years later, when little children are underfoot and bills are due and a job has been lost and a medical scare has been diagnosed, then we wonder what happened to all that beauty. Marriage has lost a little luster, parenthood is less glorious, and home building is now more sweat than sweet. That's when men and women in America leave their marriage. They're unaware God's presence in the rugged times as well as the smooth. Our challenge is to recognize that everything has a time and a season and a reason, and we have to trust God to pull off even the painful moments for his glory. Even those painful moments, they're all in his hands, all in his perfect time. Verse 11, there's the statement, he has set eternity in their heart. So that no man will not find out the work which God has done from the beginning even to the end. Because man is trying to find it out. Why are we always on the finding out process? Why are you always scoping things out? I'll tell you, because God designed us that way. He doesn't design animals that way. They don't care about anything. They care less. They just live their life. When Matthew was 13, I said, what do you want to be when you grow up? Because I want to be a dog. They don't have to think. They just lay around the house. You know, take a look at a dog. After it's been well fed, you think it's theorizing about life? No, it's lying next to the heart, just having a great time. You can't do that, neither could I. We live a whole day, an active day, a hard day. Then we put our head in the pillow at night. Finally, I could rest. I don't rest. For an hour, I'm going over this and that and this and that, because that's the way we are designed. We are thinking people. We are philosophical people in our nature. That's why I love the book of Ecclesiastes. It's philosophically driven. It's asking the questions we all ask. Why am I here? What am I doing? Where am I going? Why do we ask those questions? Because the Bible says God has put eternity in our hearts. We know what the animal kingdom does not know. We were made, as we sang today, for more than this. There's a purpose, it's a plan, and it extends far beyond time into eternity. Augustine prayed, oh God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts will be restless till we find our rest in you. That's the message of Ecclesiastes. 12 chapters of restlessness we're seeing until he finally gets those bright lights. We'll hit it eventually in the climax of chapter 12 of rest in God. But he deals with your heart and mind, the questions that we arise, because we know there's something more to life. And the atheist and the agnostic denies the heart that God has given them. They're living in a capital D denial, because no human being was ever designed not to think about why they are here and where they are going. That's eternity in our hearts. Missionary Don Richardson wrote an award-winning book entitled Eternity in Their Hearts. And he catalogs, this is amazing to me, it's fascinating, 25 cultures in the world removed from the Bible, removed from Christianity, cultures that never heard the truths I'm telling you this morning. And when the gospel was presented to those cultures, those people in culture groups instantly gave their hearts in groups to Jesus Christ. Why? Because they were yearning for God. There's a big atheistic movement in the world today. It's a movement of denial. It's a movement that says, I'm not going to listen. Forget about listening to God. They say, I'm not listening to my own heart anymore. They've killed their own heart. Because every human being has in their heart eternity. It's a desire and a design for something more. And God made us to look for him. And man won't find out that work which God has done from the end to the beginning. Which means try as hard as you want, and we do. We cannot mastermind the difficulties, the detours, and the disturbances of daily life. And so what do? You rest. And you realize he has perfect timing. His plans are exquisite. And even when life doesn't seem to make sense, it makes perfect sense to God. I like the way Annie Johnson Flint put it. In a factory building, there are wheels and gearings, cranks, pulleys, belts, either tight or slack. Some are whirling swiftly, others turning slowly. Some are thrusting forward, some are pulling back. Some are smooth and silent. Some are rough and noisy, pounding, rattling, clanking, moving with a jerk. In a wild confusion, in a seeming chaos, they're lifting, pushing, and driving, but they're doing their work. From the mightiest lever to the smallest cog or gear, all things move together for the purpose planned. Behind the working is a mind controlling and a force directing and a guiding hand. And so when things are working for the Lord's beloved, some of those things could be hurtful if they stood alone. Some might seem to hinder. Some seem to draw us backward. But they work together and they work for good. All the thwarted longings, all those stern denials, all the contradictions, so hard to understand. But there's a force that guides them, speeds them, retards them, stops and starts and guides them. It's your heavenly Father's loving hand. Let's bow together. Very quietly now, no movement. It's highly possible that God has orchestrated the events of your life to bring you to this place in time where you could see the need to have a relationship with His Son. God has put eternity in your heart for one reason. So you could spend eternity with Him. He offers you today the gift of life. It comes through the pain and the sacrifice of His loving Son. If right there where you're seated, you would release your life to His loving Son who died and rose again for you, your life will never be the same. You will live each day with eternity in your soul. And there will be a purpose and a pleasure that you've never known prior to this moment in time. But it requires your life given to the God who created you. Is there something stirring in your soul right now? Something that says it's time to make that decision for Jesus Christ. If that's your personal desire, then I would just ask you to take your right hand and lift it good and high. And that lifted hand would say to me, Pastor, I'm making that decision for Christ right now. Pray for me in this moment of dedication to Him, and I will do that. If that's where you're at, lift your hand good and high right now. God bless you, those of you who are Christians and love Him or seeking to walk with Him. Thank you. Thank you. And God bless you, my friend. If you would, just pray in your heart with me as I pray this aloud. Heavenly Father, I recognize I've made many mistakes in life. Thank you for loving me just the way I am. I'm grateful that you sent your Son to die in my place. I accept His sacrifice for all my past and present sin. Would you cleanse me right now, Father? Would you relieve me of my sadness? Would you release me to live the life that you have planned? Here's my life. I'm giving it to you just like your Son gave His life for me. Accept me right now as your beloved Son. Let me live with eternity in my heart. Let me enjoy a personal relationship with you beginning now and carrying all the way through heaven. This is my prayer. I ask it in Jesus' name. God's people said, amen. 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 Amen.